Video game music is better than the music you like. Now, this statement assumes a couple of things before you yell at me. One, that the music you like is in fact not also video game music. And two, that my opinion on music is universally correct and everyone should agree with me. But that is most regrettably not the world we live in. So, if you're a fellow video game music enjoyer, then hello to you. Thank you for stopping by. While this video is not necessarily targeted to you, if you stick along for the ride, perhaps you can appreciate some new video game music you might not have heard before, or at least indulge in my stories about them and share in the passion for the art form. But if you're not particularly into video game OSTs or original soundtracks, then this video's for you. Perhaps you enjoy the music that plays on your local radio station or tunes that top the charts, or you simply don't think pieces of music found in interactive media like this can be of the same artistic standard or as enjoyable to your ears as whatever it is you listen to. And I'm here today to tell you that in my humble and objectively correct opinion, you're wrong. And video game music is one of the most incredible art forms out there that deserves as much respect as any other. I'll be talking about video game music in isolation, as well as a tool for enhancing stories, and the unique ability it possesses to tell its own stories, covering music from Hollow Knight, Persona, Pokemon, Doom, Fire Emblem, Hades, and more. And as a disclaimer, I know essentially nothing about music theory or the crafting of tracks. I'm just a big music enjoyer trying to explain their passion for this wonderful art. And there are amazing channels who do know about music theory, who break down video game songs. So if you like this, I think you should really give them a watch because they can explain it much better than I can. My name is Pete from Pete Repeat, and join me as I try to explain to you why I think video game music is better than the music you like. Let me start today by saying that I love music. I personally believe that it is one of the most underrated of art forms, and while that might sound insane considering how large the music industry is, allow me to explain. Music in the modern age is primarily used as background noise. It is the backing track to your daily life. It's what you play while you're in the shower, while you're driving to work, while you're doing housework. When I sat down to write this script, I was listening to music in the background. It is almost always done while you're doing something else, forever in the background, and I think music deserves more respect than that. It deserves to be in the foreground. This is not to say that I don't love other forms of media, because I absolutely do, and the majority of the videos that end up being on this channel will most likely be about TV shows and movies, because I love them dearly. But I've got a real special place in my heart for music. It is so powerful, it can control your emotions like nothing else, if you allow it to. For you watching this video right now, how long has it been since you last sat down to listen to some music? Not while you ate your dinner or cleaned your bedroom or walked your dog, but you just sat down and listened. I'm willing to bet it's probably quite a while if you've done it at all. And if there's one thing you can take away from this video today, I think it's that. You should sit down and just listen to music more. It can be genuinely as thrilling as watching a movie or a TV show. Now, you might be thinking and saying right now that video game music is exactly the same as any other type of music. It is in the background of the game by its definition. It's the soundtrack you hear while you're playing the game in front of you. And you'd be absolutely right. But here's where I think the difference is. If you spend that time to sit down and listen to music, truly listen to it, I think you get a very different experience from listening to video game music as you would to any other sort. While you may appreciate your favorite song a little more if you listen to it in its isolated form, or maybe even gain a different perspective on it, I think that a good video game soundtrack has so much depth, so much intricacy in its anatomy, that there's an almost limitless amount to be gained from truly understanding a soundtrack. And not to mention that more often than not, video game soundtracks have to enhance and tell a story without lyrics, which I think makes the feats it accomplishes even more impressive. Amazing music is undoubtedly everywhere. It's just that for me, it seems to crop up in video games more often than not. Video game music has some absolutely incredible composers making beautiful songs, even out of the context of the games they're present in. And I think writing them off because they're from a video game is doing them a massive disservice. You don't need to know the story of these games to appreciate how incredible the music is. From motivational epics in Octopath Traveler, composed by Yasunori Nishiki, to Doom Eternal's powerful aggression composed by Mick Gordon. To genuinely breathtaking orchestral symphonies from Ace Combat, composed by Keiki Kobayashi. To the insane complexity of Hollow Knight Strings, composed by Christopher Larkin. There is so much to love in video game music. It's not reserved to any one genre, to any one feeling or mood. It is anything and everything it wants to be, and there is so much beauty in that. But that's just the superficial part of video game music. They are objectively gorgeous tracks, but when you experience them in the right context, in the games they're in, they take on another meaning. And now, I'd like to talk about video game music as a tool for enhancing stories. Music in general has the power to control your emotions. A melancholic song can make you feel sad, an upbeat one can make you feel happy or excited. This isn't news to anybody in particular. But this control over emotion is never more present than in video game soundtracks. The same thing can probably be said for movie soundtracks too, though I think, generally speaking, movie music rarely comes close to the level of character, cohesive tone, and theming that video game music does. There truly is so much weight put on the back of video game music, and I feel as a component of the storytelling whole, music has a much larger percentage of that whole in video games than it does in other media. In terms of relaying information to an audience, video game music provides tone, mood, and feeling, as well as instructing an audience on setting and character all at the same time. And to give an example, I'd like to talk about a children's game. Bear with me. Pokemon Explorers of Sky is arguably my favorite Pokemon game of any, helped massively by its frankly amazing soundtrack. It has incredible epic tracks, heartfelt emotional tracks packed to the brim with sorrow, happy joyous tracks, and everything in between. Now, towards the climax of the story up to this point, spoilers, I suppose, for this game that came out in 2009? Short version of the story is that you have to save the world, but immediately before this moment, you've just had to say goodbye to a very dear friend, knowing that you will never see them again. And you've also just found out that if you succeed in your mission and actually save the world, then because of diverging timelines, you will no longer exist, leaving your best friend behind to survive on without you. To this point, you have journeyed across time and space, collected the necessary artifacts, found a hidden world, and stopped the primary villain who was out to ensure you did not succeed. And as you approach your final destination, still trying to process all the information you've just been given, you stand at the base of the enormous Temporal Tower, knowing that you must journey to the top, where the final boss awaits you. And one way or the other, this will be the end of your life. And in that moment, the music kicks in. The low, constant tone has a sense of foreboding, acknowledging the enormity of the task in front of you, the size of the Temporal Tower. And as you take that second to understand what must be done, to continue walking towards your own doom for the benefit of the world, despite at this point in the story just being tired after everything you've done, knowing that you have one last mission, a determined, hopeful melody is laid on top. There is a constant feeling of ascension to this track, a literal and metaphorical rise, both in the actual musical notes being played and symbolizing your climb of the tower you're about to try and take on, while also pulling double duty and inspiring a feeling of hope in its ascending tone. All in a matter of seconds, One song has told you about the conflicting emotions of the protagonist, gave you information on the setting of Temporal Tower, and made the player more acutely aware of what comes after this mission is finished. This now feels like the final level. You, of course, will then die to Porygon and his stupid discharge about 72 times, but that's not the point. This is just one very tiny example, but it exemplifies the power that music can have on a story. Without this musical inclusion at this exact juncture in the story, it wouldn't have had the same impact as it did on me the first, second, and 17th time I played it. Music is a big part of why I kept coming back to the Mystery Dungeon series, for moments like these that are capsules of time, and whenever I hear this music, I'm taken back to the first time I heard it, and how I felt, which was so complicated because I was happy to be finishing the game and sad for the story and motivated to get it finished, and it was perfectly represented by the game and its music in front of me. It sounds silly, it's a stupid little children's game, but things like this live with you forever. To give one more example, I'd like to talk about not necessarily one moment of a few seconds, but a whole song that elevates the story being told. Persona 5 has become one of my favorite games of all time, and there's a lot of different factors that go into that. Its story, voice acting, direction, gameplay, characters are all elements, but good god, the Persona 5 soundtrack is gorgeous. It's been said a lot online, and I think the praise is deserved. Well done, Shoji Meguro. While there are countless tracks I could talk about that had an impact on me, such as Blooming Villain, Life Will Change, Price, Rivers in the Desert, Gentle Madman, I Believe, Our Beginning, 3 and Mask Away, and maybe 17 others, I won't talk about all of them, as much as I'd like to. Instead, I'd like to talk about one song, a song that plays at a very interesting point in the game. Mild spoilers for Persona 5 ahead. Up to this point, you've started creating your group of Phantom Thieves, and you've been changing the hearts of villains via entering and altering their subconscious, forcing them to admit to their crimes and to genuinely regret and repent their sins. But it's after you're feeling on top of the world and untouchable that you're requested to change someone else's heart, a person who can't deal with their own trauma anymore and needs an escape. You're not changing the heart of a villain this time, you're trying to help someone who is damaged by their past. But you're not sure why or exactly what's happened for this character to be so traumatized. And so you explore their subconscious and you start to uncover a genuinely horrifying story of a girl who was convinced that she was the reason her mother killed herself, reliving the day that while walking together, her mother stepped out in front of a car. But her being at fault was a lie that was reinforced by people around her.
Child.
You killed her!
You're a police murderer!
Why don't you say
You're
something?
You're the one who killed her!
That's right. I killed Mom.
So now you have a girl who cannot forgive herself for the death she thinks she caused and the pain she inflicted on those around her. Those same people who told her that she was wrong. And while you're uncovering this brutal, painful story, you hear this. I don't know if you can have music cry, but that guitar sure sounds like it's crying. On a first listen to the song, you may just hear the upbeat drums, the nice rhythms, the elegant and beautiful way the guitar is being played. But I feel like this tells us so much more about this girl. Futaba, as a character, once you get to know her, is this fun, quirky personality, a little socially awkward, but incredibly endearingly so. She has a lot of energy, love, and loyalty to give, but all of that has just been quashed under the weight of all of this trauma that she's been through and is still experiencing. This song shows it beautifully. It tells us there's a person somewhere under here, if only you can help her out of this dire situation. There is so much emotion baked into this song, so much sorrow and longing and guilt. In the game, you are literally inside somebody's mind, exploring how they feel and interpret the world. And with this as the backing track, you see and you feel exactly what she sees and feels. You can feel her genuine personality in this song, but you can also feel the unbearable weight of her entire life crushing her, with her calling out for help. It is a perfect representation of the situation you're in at that point. It gives you a crystal clear understanding of the pain and trauma this girl is feeling. She wants her mother back, but she feels like she doesn't deserve her. She's guilty of being the one to cause her death while battling with the truth that deep down, it wasn't her fault. And this is expressed through this beautiful track that makes you feel those emotions right alongside her. And then you go and find the track on Spotify after you've played the game, and then you see the track is called When Mother Was There? Oh my God! Because she's like reminiscing on the days when her mother was there. It's another reason why the song is kind of upbeat, because it's happy memories, but now they're tinged with sadness and grief. God damn it, Persona 5 is the greatest game ever. Of course, the story and the reveal of it is what makes this part of the game emotional. But I'm very confident in saying that if this piece of music wasn't included during it, it wouldn't have had the same impact, and it elevates it to one of my favorite parts of the game. God, I love Persona 5 so much. These two examples I've given are songs that enhance a particular moment in a game by themselves. But what really takes video game soundtracks to another level is when there is a concurrent theme represented in different points in the game on different songs. While I said that my knowledge of musical theory is very limited at the start of the video, I'd like to very quickly talk about leitmotifs. It's something of a common phrase on the internet these days, but in case you don't know what it is, a leitmotif is a recurrent theme throughout a musical piece, something that keeps cropping up to reinforce a certain mood or feeling or character. This term isn't by any means exclusive to video games at all. In fact, leitmotifs are more commonly found in movies, the most famous examples being something like Darth Vader's Imperial March.
Okay, so because of like copyright and stuff, I can't actually play the Imperial March, but like, you guys all know how the Imperial March sounds, right? Like, you know, bum 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 bum. You get it. You know the Imperial March.
It not only sets a tone, but also reminds you that as soon as you hear that theme, you know who you're dealing with. Other examples may be Indiana Jones's theme that plays whenever Indy does something heroic. Or the amazing audio design in Into the Spider-Verse, featuring the terrifying audio of the Prowler. Whenever you hear that, whatever it is, screeched thing, you know that the Prowler's around. When these musical pieces reoccur throughout a movie, it reinforces the tone, setting, or character in the scenario it's used. But when leitmotifs get used in video games, it takes soundtracks to another level. Many of the tracks I've already mentioned in this video have leitmotifs, but for a different example, I want to talk about Hades. Spoilers for Hades. Hades is an awesome roguelike game where you, the son of the god of death, must escape the underworld. It's made by Supergiant Games, and it took up just so much of my time in late 2020 and early 2021. The art, voice acting, gameplay, and in particular, music are all incredible, and if you haven't played it, I would highly recommend it. On the opening title screen of the game, you're greeted by this. Already, there's a tone being set of a dark, brooding game, but more importantly, a leitmotif trap has been set. This little ditty is already in your head, and it gets played every single time you die in the game, which, if you're anything like me, is quite often. This is a different track, but maintains the same theme. This is a textbook leitmotif, and while that is in and of itself very cool, it gets taken to another level when you finally make it all the way through Tartarus, past your future lover, hello Meg, I love you, through Asphodel, through Elysium, and you make it to the surface. This is after, if you're like me, death after death after death, where this is drilled into you time after time after time. But when you make it to the surface, there's one more challenge, and it's none other than the god of the dead himself, your father, Hades. And he's not in a chatty mood, so the fight begins. And here's how it begins.
Hades.
only do we get the same leitmotif, the actual theme of death in the game for the god of death, but it's been instrumented differently with a metal lineup, which only progresses as you go through the various phases of the fight with him.
Stop it, Dad! I just want to go outside!
The reveal of finding out that Hades is the final boss, as well as that bell tolling to begin the fight, added to the leitmotif you've been hearing the whole game, but now remixed into a metal song, all of it combined makes you go, oh, shit. And while leitmotifs are awesome, and Hades does it particularly well, there's one other game that employs them possibly even better, while adding references and remixes to its own tracks throughout its whole soundtrack. And it's a game that you've probably heard of if you've been on the internet at all in the last 7 or so years, and that game is Undertale. I can't tell you anything about Undertale you probably haven't already heard before, but safe to say that while I'm not as much of a fanatic about the game as some people are, it's still comfortably in my top 5 games of all time, with many songs on its soundtrack consistently making their way into my Spotify Wrapped each year since I played it in 2016. Undertale is an incredibly charming game, primarily due to its writing, but there is so much that can be gleaned from dissecting its soundtrack, to the point where the songs that reference each other start to tell their own story, separate from the narrative in the game. And to give an example, let's talk about Metaton. Metaton is a fan favorite character in the game, though really all of them are, I suppose, and is an overly charismatic sentient robot that's a TV show host and also seeks your destruction, just for funsies. You're constantly running into Metaton, where he sets you up with an elaborate TV-based challenge where if you fail, you die. Like a quiz show, a cooking show, a live news report, and a musical, I suppose. He eventually takes up residence at the end of The Core, essentially the electrical hub of the entire underground where the game takes place. And when you eventually get to fighting Metaton, not only do you turn him into a super sexy robot that made many people question their sexuality, but his battle theme begins to play. By itself, this track is funky as all hell, but with the context of the rest of the game, it becomes even better. This track, known as Death by Glamour, references many of Metaton's other themes that plagued during each of the trials he put you through. And while most other characters in the game have 1, 2, or at most 3 themes to this point, Metaton is extra and has 9 total up to this point in the game, and not including the genocide run, don't come at me, Undertale fans. Many of these tracks have references themselves in other tracks to this point, and they all come together in this masterpiece of a song. So for example, you can hear the melody of The Core in the opening of Death by Glamour as well. You can hear another section of the melody in Death by Glamour in It's Showtime, Live Report, and Death Report. And another section can be heard in Metal Crusher and Last Episode. What I love about this song is it is nearly entirely composed of themes you've already heard in the game up to this point. Those themes, though, just feel like tiny little parts of the Metatonne whole, and this now feels like the Metatonne totality that you're fighting. Perhaps rather fittingly, during the course of the fight with Metatonne, he is taken apart piece by piece, losing his arms, then his legs, until he is just torso and head. Losing those pieces represented by those themes that are brought together by this song. Until, after the fight, that song is gone, and all that's left, along with an outpouring of love and admiration for Metatonne, is this song instead. Which is so incredible because this is a different version to the same song that played when Metatonne was doing a musical number on you earlier in the game. And it's so perfect because the first version of this song is superficial. The melody is there, but it lacks any heart. While the version that plays after you beat Metatonne is much more sincere, which perfectly represents what Metatonne is feeling and doing at both of those times. Death by Glamour is a wonderful song, in and out of context. It's wonderfully structured, and this is what I meant at the start of the video. If you take the time to really listen to a video game soundtrack, it tells you things you can't get from music anywhere else. It tells you stories. And you can experience these stories with me, because I'm going to be streaming Undertale on my Twitch page this Sunday at twitch.tv/PeteQuinnell. I'll be starting a brand new playthrough, and it's going to be fun, and there'll be silly voices and stuff. twitch.tv/PeteQuinnell. Thank you. Now, before I ramble on for too much longer, because I could, I want to leave you today with one final example of why video game music is the best. And this, for me, is the best example I can give of a video game soundtrack telling its own story. I'm going to talk about Fire Emblem Three Houses. If you've never played a Fire Emblem game before, it's a fantasy strategy game where you command your units on a battlefield and try to win the battle, of course. There's also loads of story, amazing voice acting, direction, art, and a bunch of other stuff, but let's just focus on the battling for now. In Three Houses, whenever you're in a battle, the theme for that battle is playing whenever you're on the overview of the map and moving your units around. However, for every one of these tracks in the game, there is an alternate version of that track, and that version plays whenever you engage in combat with another unit. The camera zooms in and the music seamlessly transitions between the two versions. Once combat finishes, it zooms back out to the overview and the music goes back to the first version. These two versions of each track are called Rain and Thunder. Rain for the overview, Thunder for combat. And this is present across every battle theme in the game. Now, you may already be able to tell some of the differences between the Rain and Thunder tracks. In the Thunder versions, there's a lot more emphasis on heavy percussion. The tracks tend to lose a lot of the melody and instead become more rhythmic. And a lot of the legato notes become staccato, which is to say that notes that flow into one another are instead replaced with shorter, sharper notes that don't join. So, for a vocal example, something like la 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 would be replaced with la la la. throughout the whole game, you're being taught in every battle that when combat hits, the music gets more aggressive, there's less flair, less melody, it's more direct and to the point, and it's harsher, which perfectly fits a combat scenario. But then, you get to one certain battle. If you happen to choose the Silver Snow route when you play the game, you get the final battle. And genuinely, I'm not going to spoil what it is here because I think you should play the game and experience it yourself. Regardless, the final battle begins and the rain version of the track starts. It's grand, it's epic, but there's also a ton of emotion there as well. This fight is not being fought for glory or triumph, but because you don't have any other choice. You don't want to fight this person, you've been through a lot together, but now, there's no other way. The rain version of the track on its own is sorrowful, filled with regret. So when you enter combat, you expect the usual, the melody to disappear, the drums to kick up, the more aggressive, harsher version of the track. But that's not what happens. Instead, you get this. Lone piano, playing a solemn, somber melody. It's the antithesis of what you'd expect at this moment, and it makes you stop, listen, and feel the regret, the anguish of what's happening in the battle right now. The lives lost, and the lives yet to be lost. There's more sadness and sorrow and mourning packed into this one piano than there is in the entire orchestra in the rain version. It tells you, the player, this is no ordinary fight. And it tells the story. The story that no matter how many battles you've gone through, no matter how much thunder you've caused in the rain, there will always be a consequence to your actions. There have been lives lost, countless by your own hand through the game to this point. Are you willing to take one more? To take the one life you never wanted to? It's tragic, a sense of hopelessness overshadowing the whole battle. It takes you on an unexpected journey, one that can only be achieved through hours and hours of reinforcing your perception of what should happen, only to subvert those expectations and replace it with something so desperately heartfelt and calling for attention. And you can only experience something like that with video game music. So, you know what? No. Video game music isn't better than the music you like. Because video game music should be the music you like. Thank you so much for watching. I'm going to be doing more video essays on random topics soon, whatever I feel like making them on, and whenever I feel like making them. The topics will vary, so be prepared for a variety of things in your subscription feed if you choose to subscribe. I've wanted to make this for quite a while, and if you're watching it, that means I did it. And that's nice. It's been a long time coming. Thank you for sticking with me through it, and hopefully I'll see you in the next one.